Hello once again, welcome to SFF 180. Thomas here, your host as always, and on today's interview I am very, very pleased to be joined by John Scalzi. Hello John, welcome. And
hello,
thanks.
How are you?
I'm well, good to see you.
Good to see you as well. Yes. Okay. I think this is the first time that I've seen you since, was it Armadillo Con way back when?
Or no, actually, it was, we ran into each other like for 2 minutes in Chicago last year. It was like, hi.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
the 2 minute, okay, I recognize and we're waving and we're moving along as quickly as possible.
Hey, yeah, but are you going to be in Pittsburgh? Are you going to be there this year in Pittsburgh?
I'm going to try to be there in Pittsburgh. Okay. I'm really super happy with the Nebula Award slate this year. There's lots of really good stuff on there.
Solid slate.
And also a number of people who I really like are nominated. And then, of course, just generally speaking, the Nebula Weekend, I have a fond attachment to it, having been the president of CIFWA.
Yes.
So I'm going to try to. It's just a matter of scheduling. But provided I'm not consumed by a bear or otherwise have some sort of life emergency pop up, then I'm planning to be there. Yes.
Good. Well, let's hope so. All right. Anyway, John has a new novel coming. John, well, as you know, many of you know, John is the winner of 3 Hugo Awards, including the Best Novel Award in 2013 for Red Shirts, a sort of a loving homage to television SF and the act of writing in general. He's also won the Campbell Award for Best New Writer, the Locus Award, God knows what else. And on March 21st, this coming Tuesday, he has a new novel, Back to Space Opera, for John, with a new novel called The Collapsing Empire. And also on Tuesday, he launches a 22-city promotional tour, beginning in Lexington, Kentucky, and wrapping up on my birthday, April 27th, in San Francisco, where your opening band apparently is Cory Doctorow.
Either I'm his opening band or he's my opening band. I think we'll have to flip a coin.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's. But you know, or we could just co-headline like Sting and Peter Gabriel did, or something.
That's it. Yes, do a bit of each other's stories and
exactly.
Okay. Well, let's chat a bit about the new book. Now, this is a new space opera Scalziverse, as it were, for you. The Old Man's War thing is done, and you're moving on. And one of the things that defines this particular universe is you've come up with this way. You know, these days it's déclassé in science fiction to just sort of pretend the laws of physics don't exist. You know, you can't just have Sulu press the button on the console that says there are no physics and go faster than light, but writers try to find, you know, these fun ways to cheat science.
Sure.
And you have come up with this concept of the flow, which describe a little bit about that and sort of the inspiration for that. Like, what was kind of the kernel of inspiration for that particular notion?
Well, I think you're absolutely correct in the sense
that it's
not. I'm very strongly of the opinion that the speed of light is not just a law, it's a good idea. That you, if you are going to have a universe in which people travel in a convenient amount of time to distant star systems, that you have to find a way around the speed of light. And I did that in Old Man's War with the skip drive. In this case, it's the flow. And the flow is, it's sort of a takeoff on two concepts that are rooted in actual physics hypotheses. One is the basically the Alcubierre warp bubble, where you would actually take a bit of time space and detach it from the rest of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
And then within that, because that bubble is no longer constrained by the rules of time space, you can move it around as fast or as slow as you want. And everything inside those bubbles still conforms, and then it just reattaches and stuff. The flip side of that, it takes an enormous amount of energy that we don't have, and there are other small details. And then the other thing is the idea, very hypothetical things about brain theory, that's B-R-A-N-E, where basically one of the ways that our, you know, speculation of the universe starting were these vast multi-dimensional brains, which are basically planes of existence that sort of scraped against each other and the friction caused the Big Bang. This is a gross and heinous oversimplification, that everybody knows. But the idea of it was, what if, in the overly complex sort of situation of it, is what happens if you were to take these, I got a cat, by the way, just popped up.
That is fine. We just racked up about 400 more views on the video just for
that. There
we go. Yeah, there we are.
This is Sugar. She's one of the scamper beasts.
Okay. Well, your personal assistant, I see.
Yes, exactly. So what happens if, for example, you take a, you posit a sort of brain-like structure that interacts with our universe, but reacts sort of like a warp bubble, which is to say, when you enter it, you are no longer bound by the specific laws of our universe, and therefore you can go faster simply because that's what you're allowed to do.
Yeah.
Right? So that's the overly complex thing. The shorter version is the flow acts like a river. You have no control over it, but you can enter it, you can go with the flow, and then you can exit where you're allowed to exit. And in this sort of formulation, you don't have engines that work within the flow. It would basically, all spaceships are like canoes. You are entirely dependent on the flow of the river, so to speak, to get you where you want to go.
Okay.
And so that's basically how I get around. Now, there's some effects of that, which are if you don't have control of the flow, then you don't have any control of where it goes in, where it goes out. And so where it comes in and goes out, you're kind of stuck with those being the places that you can do business. So a lot of the systems within the interdependency, which is the empire that exists, are not near habitable planets, or what we would think is habitable planets. You basically have to make them habitable with, space stations or digging underground and
tunneling,
all that sort of stuff.
Right.
Which helps give rise to the idea of everything has to be interdependent, otherwise we're all doomed. So the development of the faster than light system also helped develop sort of the social and political system that is included in the book.
Right. Because without resources from these other worlds and the linking of these worlds, just no one would survive. It's like they're sort of forced by circumstances. I like the reference to you. It's all very, again, natural. The way in which you refer to shoals and using that kind of sort of descriptive language, I think, kind of made it easy to visualize the concept. And one of the things it made me think of something similar in Kay Kenyon's series, The Entire and the Rose, which is this set in this artificial pocket universe. And one of the ways you get around in this universe is literally on boats on rivers, and the rivers are made of exotic matter. And they're separated from our universe by these kinds of brains. And I think it's a fascinating, realm of speculation in SF. But one of the political difficulties with a vast empire, let alone one that spans light years of space, is sort of maintaining this kind of cohesion, whether it's social, cultural, economical. That's always going to be a problem. Now, because of circumstances, the interdependency has to force the cohesion, but they do it through these monopolistic guilds that are run by these noble houses. So you have all these, Borgias, basically, running the in the interdependency. And despite, even in a system where they have to kind of operate that way, I think much of the story really is about how fragile a system that is, isn't it?
Absolutely. It has to be. The system is fragile, both because of the setup that is imposed by the natural forces, the flow and where it comes in and where it goes out, but also because way back when someone decided that this was the system that they were going to make and actively worked to have it be this particular way. There's nothing to... there's the natural constraints, but then there are the political and social constraints. And one of the things that I wanted people to realize, through the course of reading it, is that one is just as important as the other. The obviously the political system wants to make it seem inevitable. They want it to be like, well, obviously this is the system that we have to have. But one of the questions that I think eventually people should ask themselves is, really, is that really the way that it has to be? Or was there another way it could have been done? But I mean, the thing about anything, I mean, we had the saying in fandom, right? Mm-hmm. That if you do something once, it's a tradition. If you do something twice, it's a hallowed tradition. And the point of that is, if you do something and it just gets done and it's sufficient, then people not only think of, well, that's the way it's always been done, but they also think about, well, that is the way it should be done, mm-hmm. Because it's already been done and because all the work's been set up, and it's just easier to go to that path of least resistance.
It's just the default. And
so, yeah, it's the default. And so one of the questions that people should always be asking themselves is, why do you do it? Well, it's always the way it's been done. The thing of, well, it's always the way it's been done should not be a sufficient answer. And it's one of the questions that people in the book have to ask themselves, and that I think readers should ask themselves. Is it the way it's always been done because it needs to be, or is it because that's the way someone wanted it to be?
What's going on in the story, and I can say this much without any spoilers, is that there a particular sort of disaster is unfolding right at the moment that we are seeing a transition in power.
Right.
You know how sometimes you write stories and during the long course of writing it and editing it and thinking about it, and then it gets published and what have you, at some point, current events tend to shape themselves so that your tale suddenly has a relevance. And sometimes that's intentional. One of the tragedies in the backstory of this book and about how everything unfolded, many rulers in the interdependency, for example, have known about the instability of the flow.
Mm-hmm.
And how... Because they've always been at the mercy of it. But they've always sort of convinced themselves, oh, it's always going to work for us. Again, this attitude that it's always worked, so it always will work. And when the realization hit them, there was a lot of denialism. They either denied that it was a problem, or they felt that, all right, it is a problem, but it's not economically or politically expedient to do anything about it. And this decision just led to the loss of lives, and the loss of entire worlds, you know, being cut off from the flow. And this is, and it just seems that there's, I don't know if this was intentional or just sort of ancillary to it all, but there's some commentary there, perhaps on present day anti-science attitudes that we have, whether it's climate denial, that sort of thing. And were you thinking about that when you were kind of putting together this backstory, or was it just serendipitous?
Well, I think it is a small c conservative thing, not conservative like we're talking about American politics, but just in a way that people are like, don't mess with the thing, don't mess with the thing that we've got.
Rock the boat.
And this is not something that's original to our time. I mean, Ibsen did a play where, you know, a guy discovered that the local spring, that people came for health purposes was actually contaminated. And he told people about it, and their response was, don't tell anybody, right? Mm-hmm. It's the same sort of thing. It's like, we don't want to mess up the thing that we have. We're going to kick it down the road. So it's not just a current thing. This thing happens all the time. Anytime that you can kick the can down the road, you're going to kick the can down the road. Now, in the case of now, I mean, obviously we live in a world where environmental concerns are an issue, and not only an issue, but we are really concretely seeing evidence that things are just not normal. The fact that we've had two years in a row where the temperatures in the Arctic were 30 or 40 degrees Fahrenheit above normal should give everybody pause. And you can say, well, it's El Niño or it's just cyclical or whatever. But a lot of that is also, I don't want to think about it. I'm going to concoct a reason for this not to be something that's impinging on my consciousness. So in modeling this behavior, I don't think that it's necessarily a commentary or satire on what's going on in the world today, although obviously it has applications. It's commentary and satire on the way that humans are. Mm-hmm. And here's the thing about humans. which is we're running the same software that we were running, you know, 100,000 years ago, right? So we're still 1.0. And so this thing of that's going to be someone else's problem, kick the can down the road. It happened to the Greeks. It happened to the Romans. It happened to, you know, the Middle Ages. It happened to, you know, everybody. And it's happening now because humans are who they are.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna deny, you know, that certainly as I was writing it, you know, there are going to be some parallels to the current world, and it's, you know, and anybody who reads it are going to go is going to go, yeah, that's there.
But it's just all part of a long-standing pattern.
But it's all part of a long-standing pattern. It's, you know, humans, alas, have stayed the same and for thousands and thousands of years, which is terrible in one sense because now we do have the ability to wreck things globally. But as a writer, is great because it means 200 years from now, when someone comes across the collapsing empire, they're like, "Wow, this, this still applies." Tragically,
Scalzi fellow is quite prescient. Yeah, well,
he knew what he was all about.
Yeah, and the lesson of history too, which never seems to get learned, which is that you kick the can, but then you eventually run out of road. You always run out of road. The Greeks and the Romans. And they all ran out of road. And
it's not so much that.
But you never think it will happen to you.
Well, no, it's not that you run out of road. The road keeps going, but there's only so far you can kick the can. Whether you as a person or you as a culture, or something like that. Someone else, and eventually somebody will come along and go, "We're not going to kick that can anymore. We have a whole new can that we're going to kick."
Okay, well, I think we've extended the Coke Zero metaphor for it to extend.
Yes. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to advertise for Coke Zero. I'm just drinking.
You have a style of dialogue that has become a trademark, I've noticed. And some of your...
What a very polite way of putting it.
No, what I mean is some of your most entertaining scenes are what I like to call the Scalzi showdown. Which is sort of you two characters engage in this kind of like verbal high noon shootout. Where each one is trying to outmaneuver the other. And in this book you have, I think, one of the best characters you've ever written in Kiva, who's great. She has much higher F-bomb quotient. It's wonderful. And are these as fun to write as they are to read? Because I get the impression that this comes very much from, you talk about your own background where you're academically trained in argument and debate and that sort of thing. And how do you do that at the same time while sort of making sure that everyone else isn't just sort of sounding too much like you and doing it with it? Well, I mean, with Kiva, it's easy. She just swears every other word, but the whole back and forth, the bantering and the debating and the, you know, outgunning each other is. Tell me a little bit about where that comes from.
Well, a lot of it is simply because you want to be able to develop character, and for me as a writer, the simplest and most efficient way for me to do that, and it's not the same for every writer, but it is for me. Is to have my characters talk because their personalities will come out of what they're saying, how they're saying it, how they're reacting to circumstances, and so on and so forth. So I do convey a lot of character and character building through dialogue, probably more so than a lot of other writers. And that's both a good thing because it is entertaining and it's very quick. The flip side of it is, and this is where, having the trademark is both a blessing and a curse, is that most of my characters are pretty verbal. Most of them are pretty smart on the uptake. Most of them are quippy. You do really have to be careful that they don't all end up sounding alike. Because this is something that people do criticize me for, and I think it's a reasonable criticism, is, they're all so clever, and part of me is like, this is a tragedy? Do you want me to write boring people? I could write boring people for you. But the point is that you do have to be careful that you differentiate them. In this particular case, the three main characters, Kiva, Cardenia, and Mars, they were easy to differentiate because one, they you know, their fundamental personalities are different. Kiva is very brash, direct, to the point, literally does not care what you think about her. And I don't want to think, I don't want to say that she's amoral, because that's not the case.
No,
but
quite the opposite, actually.
Yeah, but she is also willing to do questionable things to achieve the ends that she wants to achieve.
Mm-hmm.
Cardenia, who becomes the emperor of the interdependency, is sort of emotionally the youngest of all of them, and is catching up. And so mm-hmm. a lot of what she's doing is trying to figure out how she fits into this universe that has suddenly thrust her into a position of now you have to run it. And then finally, Mars is a scientist and is slightly more quiet, slightly more analytical, mm-hmm. And is not, I don't, he's not a character who you see, you know, really taking the lead, which is fine because we have two other characters to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he adds a really good center of gravity to the proceedings. Mm-hmm. So in that particular case, you know, developing those characters and their voices come out of a lot of what are they doing in terms of the story and what would these people be?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of developing a character is observing humans. Like, mm-hmm. I know a lot of people who are scientists, so it helps, you know, when I'm thinking about Mars, I think about my scientist friends. Not every scientist is the same, obviously, but a lot of them tend to be, they tend to be observational. They tend to be, you know, people who think first and speak later, rather than being brash and, you know, right up front. So that was, you know, a thing. I've met a lot of super talented people who are thrown into unexpected positions.
Mm-hmm.
And in that sort of sense, whether it is people who all of a sudden, you know, had a little business that all of a sudden exploded and then they became CEOs and they're like, what the hell am I doing?
Right.
Or even writers who were toiling around and then all of a sudden something hit in a really big way.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden they had to deal with, you know, just
life changes. Yeah.
Right. And then that sort of experience fuels Cardenia. And then with Kiva, I certainly know quite a lot of people who are like, I'm going to tell you what I think about this, and I don't give a shit what you think.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So in that respect, up to and including my wife, who is an awesome, awesome human being, but there is very definitely a little bit of her in Kiva.
Mm.
So, you know.
I won't ask.
Maybe not so much all the swearing. But.
Yeah, I was going to say, I won't ask which bits, so as not to get you in trouble. But Kiva, I actually thought was fairly well morally grounded for the mm-hmm. kind of life that she lives and the circumstance she finds herself in. She understands the difference between what's business, what's personal. But at the same time, she is willing to do the right thing, but without being overly sentimental about it.
Yeah. You know, well, and that's the
or sentimental that's, at all about it. She just knows, all right, I can. This is a good thing to do. I can also profit from it, which is fine. But it's also a good thing to do, and I recognize that. But you know, don't bat your eyelashes at me and expect, you know.
Right. Exactly.
Thankful.
She's not a person who's going to sit there and go, here we are on the cusp of history. You know, what a momentous occasion. We are all here, and then break out into song a la Hamilton.
Yeah.
You know, she is, you know, she's just very, very sort of straightforward. To go back to the question and to speak a little more about Kiva, she mm-hmm. was absolutely deliriously fun to write.
Oh,
because,
yeah.
You know, because she's not a particularly politic person. She gets to say things the way that, you know, in a very sort of fun way, and mm-hmm. deal with people in a way that's a hell of a lot of fun as well. I had a lot of fun writing her and writing the other characters. But again, you know, a lot of it was making sure that she was consistent to mm-hmm. To who she was. And a lot of that does come out in the initial writing of those particular characters. And, you know, I go back and obviously clean up before I go.
Mm-hmm.
And so just in first writing her, I didn't really originally intend her to swear as much as she did,
mm-hmm.
you know, because she does. I mean,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Really, really, really does. But it just turned out that that was once she did start swearing, and yeah. she swears, it's not
just
it's
went
not
full Deadwood with it, you know. Just
yeah, exactly.
Well,
But the rhythm and pattern of it mm-hmm. Really helps solidify the character. I mean, I'm gonna get people who are like, I really love the story and I really like Kiva, but did she have to swear so much? And the answer is yes. Yes, yeah. In fact, she did. She did have to swear exactly as much as she did.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the things that I had to do with the writing was, do you mind if I swear right here? Are we okay with swearing?
We are good with swearing. Yes.
Okay, so the thing is like you would have to ask yourself, where does the fuck go in this sentence? Does it go this fucking thing or this thing fucking fuck, you know, all that sort of stuff. And how many fucks do you put in and what level of intensity do you put? Because fuck is her go-to word,
yes,
right? She applies other ones.
It's a knife in her, yeah.
She's right there with it. Mm-hmm. And that was the thing too, is the you know, there is the argument that, you swear when you don't have anything else to say. But I don't think that is really true. Mm. I mean, I think this is just really her, and not just her, but her family's mm-hmm. preferred intensifier.
Yeah.
You know, it really brings it home.
Like George Carlin said, it's the spice in my stew.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. But for her, it's not the spice. It's the fucking potato, you know, and... And that's the thing, and which was really important. There is a scene with her and her mother where you have to be absolutely clear that mm-hmm. that this was not something that she picked up as an affectation. It's like this is the family patois.
Very much, yeah. But again, it's all just part of that sense of humor that balances out. Really, what's going on is quite tragic because there's this one world that mm-hmm. is. Definitely going to, that will not survive. None of them will survive if they get cut off. But this one world in particular, which is called End, which is where which is not the most you wouldn't want to see that on a tourist brochure. It's not the most appealing, but it is the world mm-hmm. where it's currently racked by again, looking at current events. There's a rebellion. There's a big war going on. There is a duke that is about to be toppled. There are refugees, people desperately trying to flee the planet. And so, and mm-hmm. in the midst of all of this, there mm-hmm. is this looming disaster, which is very few people know that it could be just a matter of days or weeks before no one can leave the planet ever. And
sure.
So there's quite a bit of weight that's going on and the complexity, the level of conflict and tension that you've got layered into this narrative here. Now let's get a bit on. Let's go on a bit to the. This is the first book now in a long-term new contract that you have with Thor, and
yeah.
so how much?
Very long contract.
Yes, and I was going to say which is great to have that sort of comfort zone to work within. But how much of this now? How much work do you have planned ahead, or are you just sort of leaving as much of it open as possible to? Write whatever your muse, dictates at some point.
The answer is I went in, we decided, and this is back in 2015, mm-hmm. right about, I guess, 2 years ago now,
yes.
about 2 years ago now, where I went in, I talked to my agent and said, let's try for a long-term contract with Tor. And we were thinking something along the lines of maybe like 5 or 6 books. Which would have been a significant amount.
Right.
And he said, okay. And so we started planning for that. And to prove to Tor that I was serious about it and that, that I wasn't just saying, give me money, mm-hmm. and we'll figure out the rest of it later, which was not going to go over particularly well with Tom Doherty.
Yeah.
He's not going to be like, oh, sure, we'll absolutely give you
money. I figured contract negotiations are at least a little more complicated than that, a little more detailed than that.
Slightly more complicated.
Give me money. It would be nice if money was all there was to it, but no, we don't live in that world. But
exactly.
Anyway.
So I knew that the give me money ploy would not work. Mm-hmm. Unless I could actually show that I had a plan. So what I did was I wrote up 13 book treatments.
Ooh.
And which some of them were sequel to Lock In, Another Old Man's War, somewhere down the line, like 4 or 5 years down the line. Mm-hmm. And so basically stuff of, here's the stuff that we're going to do that's going to be a continuing thing so that you have a hedge. You know that these books are going to sell. We're going to start a new space opera series. That's the Collapsing Empire series, which is right in the comfort zone of who my audience is and what I'm known for. So this will be the first thing right out of the gate. So this will be something that you'll be able to sell easily. Mm-hmm. And then I also have all of these one-offs that, again, will address specific, you know, financial and creative things that we know are a real concern. So I came in not only saying that these are books that I'm interested in, but also critically, these are books you can sell. And here's how you can sell them.
Right.
And then I threw in 3 YA books because I said, I know that Tor is thinking about getting more into YA. And here are 3 that if you're going to do that, you can do that too. Now, like I said, when we went in, we expected Tor to pick and choose. Like they would pick 5 or maybe 6 or whatever. Mm-hmm. What we weren't expecting was that they would say, yes, we will take all 13. but they did. Yeah. And so that was great. And that was a lot of fun. Now, but the thing was, is that the good news is that we have literally 13 concepts that we can do. And if I did nothing else but just stick with those, then we've got a solid, well thought out plan for the next decade. Mm-hmm. Now, as it happens, the way that we're considering this stuff is this is the plan, but we are okay with deviating from the plan. Like, so for example, if Collapsing Empire does really well, there are currently 2 books in the series, but we could make it into 3, mm. you know, if people are really engaged in the series. If Lock-In, which I'm writing the sequel to right now, if Head-On, which is the title of the sequel, does really well, then we'll go ahead with a book 3. And if it doesn't, okay. then we'll move into one of the standalone books. Right. And if one of the standalone books does amazingly well and people say, we want another one of those,
then we could get a sequel, potentially.
Right, exactly.
All right.
So we have flexibility in that we have a long-term ability to look at what's going on in the marketplace and what I'm doing and how people are responding to stuff and say, okay, let's tweak. But if worst comes to worst, we've got all 13 books planned out. So as far as it goes,
nice work if you can get it. Yeah.
Yeah. No, again, it's kind of the optimal situation that the default is we have a plan, you know, but we have the ability to tweak as well.
And what, if anything, can you say about, for example, any of your projects that you might have in development for film and television, or other than they come, they go, or is there anything that you're able to talk about in that arena? Okay. Usually the grunt of awkwardness means no, can't really, but...
grunt of awkwardness. The short answer is Old Man's War is still in process, which is good. You know, they're mm-hmm. taking their time, but they keep sending me option money, so that's good. Mm-hmm. So I have currently, at the time that I'm talking to you about this, and this may change by the time this goes up, 2 other projects that are under option and or under development, but we can't talk specifically about them yet.
Understood.
There might be 1 or more that gets added to that, but Hollywood, man. You know, who knows?
Yeah.
So I'm not trying to be cagey or coy or anything like that. But it is one of those things of, it's like, okay, the contract is signed. Can we talk about it yet?
Yeah.
How about now? Because I want to tell people about it.
Sure.
I
mean, yeah, that's exciting.
Not only because mm-hmm. it's cool, it is super mm-hmm. exciting, but also because it's sort of like, you know, it's actually good for my business for people to be excited about this stuff, you know?
Yeah.
And that's one of the frustrating things. It's like, Old Man's War was optioned for 2 years before we actually talked about it, right? Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons we talked about it was I finally said, you have to tell people that this thing is happening, or I'm going to start talking about it anyway, because I have a new book coming out and I want people excited. So sometimes you have to push.
Yeah.
It's
a little bit of leverage.
So things are happening. And I wish I could tell you more.
Yeah. Well, it's I'm wondering now, I mean, recently we've had, we were seeing like Westworld and The Expanse, a little bit more success with, you know, science fiction on TV.
Sure.
And so, you know, that always probably can help, you know, make the people who make these things happen and write the checks for it a bit more amenable to actually green lighting and pursuing things where they might have all, you know, the typical thing is, well, let's wait and see what, how the tea leaves are falling into place, as it were.
Yeah. Nothing succeeds like success. Right.
Sure.
So the fact that Expanse, which is wonderful, by the way, the fact that Westworld is great. And, you know, of course, also the vast proliferation of, outlets now. It's not just cable. It's not just network TV, but it's also Netflix and YouTube
and
all these other places. There are so many other places that you can sell ideas to. Quite frankly, it's a great time to be a writer with something to option. So, but again, that's the thing about Hollywood, which is lots of stuff gets optioned. The amount of stuff that actually gets made is really small, and then sometimes it takes years or decades. I mean, Dune, when it came out in 1984, had been, out for 30 years. Starship Troopers, even longer than that,
How long did Orson Scott Card was pushing Ender's Game? Like 25 years before that.
Right, exactly. And this is the thing, which is, as a writer, you're like, sometimes it's like, well, okay, do I really want them to make the movie, or do I just want to keep cashing option checks? Because the option checks are smaller, but when the movie comes out, if it's not a hit, or the TV series is not a hit, then all of a sudden it's much more difficult, usually, to get the next thing sold, because, they're going to attach the failure to your name, whether it's your fault or not.
As he was sort of breaking out, I was in email contact quite a lot with Darren Shan.
Right.
And he had just sold the rights to his Cirque de Freak to Warner Brothers, and was sort of riding high on the wave of excitement and success and, large checks from that. And then the movie came out and promptly evaporated. And so, he's very circumspect about it. You know, he says, they made the movie they wanted to make. I thought, and I thought they did a decent job. You know, it may not have been the sort of things that the fans wanted, but, you can't sort of go back and have regrets about too many things. You know, situations just sometimes play out the way they do. And you just kind of have to live with that. But you always have your books and your stories as a writer. You always have your storytelling, and that can't go away.
Well, and here's the thing, which is that a movie that is a failure, and as you got the little quotes here, will still sell a ton of books. I mean, Ender's Game broke even, right? Mm-hmm. The movie broke even. People thought it was okay. It wasn't, all that sort of stuff. I believe Orson Scott's Card sold like a million more books than he usually does, which is a huge number every year, of that book because of it. So on one sort of sense, it would have been great if, it had been a huge for him, if it had been a huge hit, and then he could go off and, all the sequels and stuff like that. But on the other hand, it still sold tons and tons of books. There's an apocryphal story that people went to Jenny Heinlein and said, isn't it horrible what they did to Starship Troopers? And she basically showed them the bestseller chart and said, look where Bob is today.
Nope. Yeah.
So I remember back when Old Man's War was still being developed for a movie, and they were like, well, we're going to have to make this sort of change and blah, 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 blah. But we're still committed to the vision. And I was like, let me say this once so that we're absolutely clear. I want you to make a movie that when people go see it, they'll say, they had to make some changes to the book, and I understand why, but the movie was true to the feel of the book, and I totally get it, and it was awesome. That's what I want you to do. So, but if you can't do that, make a movie that makes a shit ton of money, because it'll work the same for me, right?
we always want to say, you don't just write for this, you know, in the hopes of, you know, getting noticed by Tinseltown or anything like that.
No.
It's awfully nice when it comes by. And thinking to myself, you know, reading Collapsing Empire, I'm just like, boy, you know, I think there are probably just a few actresses who would dearly love to be Kiva enough that you could just hand them the book.
Yeah.
And then they'll just take it to their agent and saying, get somebody to make this because I want to play this woman.
Right. Well, no, you know, and that's the thing is that if you are writing a novel to be anything other than a novel, then you're right. Dooming your novel, or you're making it very much much more difficult for your novel to succeed. Mm. I'm very fortunate that I have a very aggressive team, mm-hmm. you know, that likes getting my stuff out there in L.A. and stuff. But the fact of the matter is, you know, two things. One, when I write the novel, I write the story that I want to read. And that I think makes a good story. And the other thing about it is, you know, quite frankly, thanks to that tour contract, I'm set. I don't need to.
Right.
I don't. If I never sell anything to LA, you know, or to movies or TV again ever, that's going to be kind of sad for me because, like I said, the option money is free money.
Sure.
You know, but I'm okay. I will be fine. I still get to write really the stories I want to write and have a good time doing it. One of the things that I'm very, very clear with people when they do ask me, it's like, how did you do it? And I was like, I did this and then I did this and then I did this. And then I also got super, super lucky. Right. Mm-hmm. And then they would go, well, no, I mean, you weren't lucky. You were good. Mm-hmm. I'm like, no, I'm good, but I'm also lucky. You know, I was very fortunate that Old Man's War came out right around the same time. A whole bunch of people were like, oh, I miss Heinlein. I wish there was another Heinlein novel. And then I showed up and I had a Heinlein novel for you. I mean, it was intentionally designed.
Very much that had that retro feel.
It was a story I wanted to tell, but it was a story I wanted to tell in that mode. And if it had come out a year earlier or a year later, there's no guarantee that that would have taken off the way it did. Red Shirt's the same sort of thing. I won a Hugo for it, which is awesome, you know, but there's no telling if it had gone the year before when Connie Willis was on the ballot or the year after when, Anne Leckie was on the ballot.
That's right. Yeah.
Then I would be in the audience clapping and going, well, you know, at least I was nominated.
Sure.
So in both of those cases, it was in some ways, it's just that was the luck of the draw. I mean, I'll take it. I still have a best novel, Hugo. Can't take it away from me. But at the same time, it was luck. It was luck that it was that particular year instead of any other particular year. And I recognize that so much of my success is luck. And it makes it easier, one, to keep my head to a manageable size, and two, to recognize that and remind people that so much of what success is completely outside of our control. Mm-hmm. You do the work, you make the opportunity for luck to happen, and then if it does happen, then you can capitalize on it. You know, except that it's not all in your hands.
The flow can always dry up, basically.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
Indeed.
Yeah, but what I've liked, you know, again, is that you have, you've recognized all of these circumstances that have helped to sort of sculpt your success, as it were, and you've acknowledging that the vast majority of people out there who write, and they could write for years or even decades, and you know, never be able to give up the day job, success always remains elusive.
Sure.
And you know, I like how you've used your position that you've gotten from your success to sort of pay it forward. So you have the big idea columns on your blog,
sure,
and that just gives a platform for to expose other writers, and and I think that and so you recognize the value of this community, whereas perhaps some other writers might not so much, and I've always found that to be commendable.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's a couple of things there. I mean, I've never been the sort of person who believes in the zero sum game, right? That my success comes at the diminution of someone else, or vice versa. And I think that's very important. I mean, particularly when writers are younger or newer, depending And they, you know, and they sort of are worried about their status or their position in the group and stuff like that. And they can feel like it's super competitive. One of the things that I think was very fortunate for me, again, luck, is that I became a novelist in my mid-30s, where a lot of the ego drive was already settled for me. I mean, I'd already been a professional writer for a decade and a half. I'd already published books. So a lot of that was not something that was a concern of mine. But the other thing is that I also believe that as a reader, you want as much out there as you can, as you can get. As a human being, you want your friends to succeed, and you want your friends to be happy. And then also just, I don't know. I mean, I just don't want to be a dick all the time. I don't want it to be.
Not all the time.
Yeah. I've been a dick just like anybody else has, but you know, but in the sense of, I think it's tiring to make everything in the world a referendum about you, mm-hmm. you know, I'm not someone who has a small ego, and I'm not someone who isn't thinking about my career, you know, in a very real and concrete way a lot of the time. But at the end of the day, you know, just centering your life on, is this always good for me, or is this always bad for me, or whatever, mm-hmm. Is going to make you crabbed and small and unhappy. So frankly,
yes, I think we see plenty of examples of that in the world. You know,
strangely we do. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it ultimately makes people happy. Or if it does make them happy, I don't want to be that person.
Yeah. That particular definition of happiness seems,
you know, right.
You know,
the one thing that science fiction and fantasy has that a lot of other places don't have it as developed is a community. The idea promulgating through it that you do pay it forward, that you you know, the recognition that you don't get where you are just on your own steam, that occasionally people are going to pop in and they're going to help you, or that sometimes when people are down, that they need help getting back up. And that is one thing that I find absolutely beautiful, I think is the word that I want to use about the community, that they actually do believe it and that it is part of the ethos. And it's something that was super easy for me to adopt. It's like, again, because I also knew that my success was in many ways accidental, right place, right time. I think it's part of my duty, you know, if you want to put it that way, to help make opportunities for right place, right time for other people, you know. If a big idea gets a book in front of people that might not have otherwise seen it, you know, is it any skin off my back to give people, you know, that space? Absolutely not. It takes me, you know, 5-10 minutes a day to, you know, put that thing up. No. Does it hurt me to retweet my friends when they're telling, you know, saying that a book is coming out or that something good has happened to them? No, it doesn't. And they're not, these aren't cookie bearing things. Mm-hmm. These are just things that you should do. So it seems to make sense to do them. And I mean, I don't think it's a big deal to do them, but I think it's important that they get done.
Yeah.
And it's easy for me to do. So why the hell not?
Yeah, because the zero sum thing game thing is just not true.
It's so exhausting. It is literally the worst thing in the world to actually see, which is like people who are talented and people who have good stuff just look at when is it my turn? When is it my, you know?
Yeah,
it should be my turn now. Or the thing where they come over to talk to you, or they come over to talk to someone else, and you see them scanning the room, looking to see if they can trade up in the conversation.
They're talking to you, but the eyes are wandering. Yes.
Yeah. Which is not always a bad thing. I mean, I have wandering eye myself simply because, you know, I'm like, oh, this person, oh, this person, this person. But you remain engaged in that particular conversation, because the thing is that, you know, even if you're going to go see that person who is famous now, You know, the person who's famous now is not necessarily the person who's going to be famous 10 years from ago. 10 years ago, Anne Leckie, I don't think, had even sold, you know, a short story. You know, she might have, but she was nowhere on the horizon.
On the radar,
and then all of a sudden, boom, you know, there she was. And it was an amazing thing. N.K. Jemisin 10 years ago was starting out, and you know, now you got the fifth season and the Obelisk Gate, and there's just these amazing books. And I pity the people who looked at Anne, who engaged in Anne and Nora in conversation at a convention or, you know, function or something like that, and were scanning the room for somebody else, right? Because not only did they miss out on the opportunity to get to know those two magnificent writers, you know, at an early age, and to think of them as peers on the, you know, on the journey, but they've sort of revealed who they are, you know. I'll tell you a story, which was 2003, my very first science fiction convention. It was TorCon, the WorldCon, and I was assigned by Patrick Nielsen Hayden to Corey, as Corey was my con buddy because he'd done conventions before and I hadn't, and Patrick was like, John's going to follow you around, and Corey was, come on it.
That's, you know, do Patrick does that. That's so cute. That's like Boy Scouts.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, and it was. Yeah. And the thing is, so I got to hang out with, I hung out with Corey and Corey's friends, which were Charlie Strauss and Justine Larbalestier and Scott Westerfield and other people. And, you know, quite honestly, what happened was that I got to, you know, sit there and talk with them. And I was like, with Corey and Charlie, and I knew who they were, and I'm like, it's so cool I get to be with you. So awesome.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be cool if, like, one day, like, you and me and you, you know, you, Charlie, you, Corey, and I were all on, like, the best novel, Hugo, Slade together. It's just so cool. And Corey and Charlie were, you know, wonderful and gracious and didn't, you know, sort of like, and now we're going to trade up from you to somebody else. When I didn't try
to trade up. They didn't roll their eyes too obviously. It was very polite.
And we were all focused on this is where we are, and we had a good time, and we became friends. Fast forward to 2009. Corey, Charlie, and I are on the best novel, Hugo, slate together.
Yeah.
And we're going to lose because Neil Gaiman and Neal Stephenson are on it too.
Yeah.
But it doesn't matter because back in 2003, you know, I wasn't like trying to trade up to, you know, find anybody else. They weren't trying to ditch me. We became friends because, you know, we became friends. And there we were on the battle together. And by that time I was much more, you know, suave than I was. And I went up to both of them. I'm like, see, remember what I said in 2003? Mm-hmm. Here we are. How cool is this shit?
Mm. That Scalzi prescience, an early manifestation. and now we will see what he predicts in his newest novel about the.
But yeah, seriously, if I was trying to trade up, you know, it's like, oh, there's Terry Pratchett or whatever. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Then I wouldn't have had that moment and I wouldn't have my friends.
Right.
So.
Yeah. I think that is pretty much going to do it then for today. I want to thank you again, John, for joining me. It's been a great pleasure to talk to you.
Yeah. Thank you, likewise.
Yeah, indeed. Okay, reminder, everybody, the book comes out this coming Tuesday, The Collapsing Empire. And so it's available for pre-order. You should find my review of it up already on the channel. And otherwise, please like if you enjoyed watching. Share the video far and wide with all of your SFF reading friends. And above all, please subscribe if you can. That is how SFF 180 grows as a channel. So one more time, with thanks to my wonderful guest, John Scalzi. Until I see all of you next time, happy reading.